Carol?
Yes.
Please let the district attorney add a executive session for personnel matter.
Yes, sir.
Tonight, we asked Frank Baxter, our emergency management coordinator, for Lower Gwinnett, to attend. Now, Frank's been our emergency coordinator for how many years? 20 years?
I think he's 20.
Yeah, so it's Frank's job to manage unusual events. And I think your position is appointed, you're appointed by the governor, is that right?
You guys recommend me to the governor appointment.
Yeah, so why don't you line up, Frank? So Frank's going to give us the background. He's our point person on this for Lower Gwinnett and COVID-19. And Frank, that mic, and you can, it's a wireless mic, so you can pitch up and talk to anybody. And afterward, Frank is done. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. That's all right.
Good evening, everyone. I was asked to come in and just talk about where we are, the status in Lower Gwinnett Township. Currently, if you've not seen it in the news, we have one family in Lower Gwinnett that currently is tested positive or presumptive, which means that locally we test them, but it actually is going to the CDC for confirmation. So the first case came down, it was a woman. And then most recently, another family member came down. So it's still just one house in Lower Gwinnett Township. On Sunday, the chief of police and the township manager actually had a conference call with Montgomery County to inform them, you know, enlighten them of the situation, and also what's the procedure to do for emergency responders. So for us as emergency responders, if we go to that street and that house, we will be notified that that particular house, we have to take extra precautions. So we're well aware and well prepared for that if it does happen. They did not share information about their address or the individuals because of their own privacy and HIPAA laws, and that makes all the sense in the world. So that's where we are in Lower Gwinnett. Right now, there's two cases. And the report just came out an hour ago, and it's still confirming just two cases in Lower Gwinnett Township. Another question, it came up about how are we prepared for an Lower Gwinnett Township for our retirement homes, or retirement communities, I should say. I did have a conversation with Mark Ross. Mark Ross is a regional manager for the Hospital and Healthcare Association of Pennsylvania, and they're right on top of it. So each of our communities are members, and just this week they had four phone calls sort of to guide them through on how to prepare for it. So they're well prepared for a potential couple cases within the community. What else? They also educate and make sure they're well prepared. They also say that they have a quick response team ready to go in the whole state of Pennsylvania. In this region, there's a team ready to go. If there's an outbreak in anywhere in this area, they would have nurse practitioners and staff, and more importantly, equipment. We all know if you try to go to the hardware store or somewhere else to get N95 respirators, you can't find them. They have a stockpile. Just in case there's an outbreak at one of the facilities, they're going to go there with all the equipment they need and they have a plan. They also engage in that exposure. So typically we'll do, if there's one person that comes down or showing symptoms and after they have a positive test, they will be isolated. Isolated means will be by themselves. Anyone that had exposure or contact with them, that usually means close proximity within 6 feet, they will be quarantined for 14 days within the nursing home or facility, I should say. What else? Also, just a great resource. I know a lot of people are, you know, watching the news and so forth, but I highly recommend the best resource you can go to is it's COVID-19 Data Hub. It's right on Montgomery County's public health website. Right there is the latest, greatest information. It'll
can you repeat that for me?
It's the COVID-19 Data Hub, H-U-B, and it's on the Montgomery County public health website. And it'll give you the latest information. They're really sort of running the show for Montgomery County with guidance of the state of Pennsylvania and now the federal government. So.
That's on our website too.
That is excellent. Thank you. I do have some handouts right from the CDC on both prevention and just some prevention treatments, and also talk about, you know, what's your risk. And so for most of us, if you went to the grocery store and somebody was there, your risk is so low, so low. But another family member, just like anyone gets a typical flu, once one person gets it, everybody in the house seems to get it. Okay? So take the standard precautions of hand washing and so forth. It talks about wash your hands and soap with soap and water for 20 seconds. Use alcohol-based hand sanitizer if you don't have any soap and water, and that hand sanitizer should be 60% alcohol. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth for unwashed hands. Avoid close contact with someone who's sick, and that means within 6 feet. Stay home, that's a key one. Stay home when you're sick. You don't want to come to work and spread it to other people. You know, if you need to cough or sneeze, use a tissue and make sure to discharge that tissue in the trash right away. Disinfect common things you touch all the time. So, you know, you're seeing a lot more wipes around places and stuff like that. It's a really good practice year-round, not just because of this, year-round, I should say. And then stay up to date. There's a lot of information thrown at us, a lot, especially the news. So the most authoritative information is the CDC, and most of the state and Montgomery County is based on the CDC or the World Health Organization information. And then it still recommends, if you have not got, get a flu shot. Even though this is not protected by the flu shot, it still will help your immune system if you do get the regular flu. So their flu shots are still available.
Frank.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned two retirement communities, Addison and Fallquist.
Four.
In Lower Roanoke.
That's correct.
Okay. I thought you said two.
No, if I did, I misspoke.
Four. What is the fourth? I have a third one down. What's the fourth one?
Silver Spring.
That's what I, right. I didn't hear you say. Fauquays,
right.
Axe.
Well, the two Axe communities.
Oh, two Axe, okay.
So, and all of them are members, and so they're being fed the right information.
I'm familiar with Axe and Fauquays being as big as they are and as well managed as they are. Has anybody from your staff or from Lower Gwinnett been in contact with Silver Street, and have you been satisfied with their answers? Because in past years, we seem to always have a problem with that.
Well, I would have to agree with you, Mr. Brandt, that we've had issues with them on their infrastructure because of their generator issue and so forth. Mm-hmm. But their medical staff and their care of their patients, I don't think we ever had a question.
Okay.
And that's not our expertise. So if the state is involved, they are licensed, and Mark Ross is a great resource to them, and he's been in contact with them.
Okay, good. Happy to hear that.
Any other questions?
I just want to add to the information gathering part. It seems that the county commissioners have daily news briefs at 3 p.m.
Right.
And you can view them right on the website.
That's correct. And right after that, we all get a status report of where we're at in each of the townships.
Okay. I understood there was, on the one case we have in Lower Gwinnett, that there was a nephew or a relative that attends GA. And they in turn shut down GA. Is that the second individual in that house that you're talking about, or is there a third?
I don't want to speak out of turn. I'm not sure 100%. I know that it's the original person.
Right.
It's a family member within the same household.
Okay. All right.
Frank, how well equipped are the hospitals in this area versus some other hospital, I'm thinking of Seattle specifically, to handle something like this?
We're really blessed in the metro Philadelphia area with the amount of healthcare institutions we have. Just in, you know, our immediate area, we have enough. Now, obviously, if we get inundated, it's a whole different story, but that's when the state's going to come in, and that's when the federal government's going to come in. As a normal load of what we're dealing with, we're well prepared.
Now, do you have any communication with the schools?
I have not reached out to schools. I did hear that There may be some more school closures, I'm not sure the latest ones.
Wyndham Mercy High School.
Okay. As a precaution.
A student was in contact with that relative, the second relative in that home.
Do you know if our county has the appropriate diagnostic kits yet?
We do have the field ones, where then it's then, it's confirmed with the CDC. So Montgomery County feels very comfortable they have enough, and the state has enough.
Did you answer for the ambulance? I'm seeing Dan back there. I'm sorry, ambulance got enough equipment, material, training, you're all set to go?
Yep. And one of the outcomes of the conference call on Sunday, when we asked about supplies, that we have, in the police department, we have an N95 mask, we have about 2 dozen of them. We can't get more. Liz Heinrich, is that her name? Heinrich, sorry. She's not here. She called me yesterday, and she was on that phone call. She is, when the supplies do come to the state, they're not going to the CBS. They're not going to go to Giant. The state's going to take control of this, and we will be a priority as first responders to get whatever supplies are coming forward.
Chief, you might not have over here.
Sure.
You might not have over.
Okay, awesome. Because we use them not for just this instance.
Right.
If I can follow up on nursing homes too.
Sure.
This is, to me, nursing homes are well, are apps in both ways. We run into this all the time with norovirus, with the flu, they'll shut down a whole wing. And I think they're doing that now. Last, 2 weeks ago, we were responding to the hallways, they met us at the front door, don't come in, because pneumonia had hit. Norovirus had spread out to states. They're very active in making sure, A, that the ambulance people don't get it, and the police don't get it. Silver String is the same way. We're down Silver String a lot. They're very cautious for us.
Okay.
I would say. And we're fortunate, Dan knows, you know, one of our officers is an EMT. He's been with the ambulance for a while. We've trained for blood-borne pathogens yearly. And not that this is what this is, but that got us all this equipment. Didn't know how to put a mask on it.
That was my next question. Is the staff, your staff trained?
We trained yearly on blood-borne pathogens. So it's all the same. To me, it's all the same thing.
Yeah, they're calling for standard precautions.
Right.
And then if we know a known source, like the residents, you'll count out even more.
And you have that room. I can't, and Craig was on the phone too, and we've got a couple. I can't say enough about what Montgomery County's done. Even as far as the 911 dispatch center, their call takers now have a separate, there's a separate group of individuals handling medical calls that are being screened further. It's not just, you know, an accident with injuries is still the same. Well, when somebody calls up and saying they're not feeling well, it's being screened further to prevent just that person, A, going to the hospital on their own. You know, we don't want that to happen. We want people to stay home. Montgomery County's been phenomenal in my view of how this has been handled so far. We're all worried about where it's going, but they seem to be really on top of it, Mark.
Yeah.
And Frank also, Frank is, you know, having Frank as a key person to talk to. Frank has the context that if things go bad, not just with this, but we've talked before about a train accident, any different thing, you know, we have the people that are in place to coordinate that event to get the resources here.
Okay, so anything the ambulance, police, or you, Frank, need from the township to address anything?
I would say right now, no. We're in good shape. You know, time will tell. Hopefully this calms down.
We also passed that on today. I talked to Tom Sullivan today. I passed on to him that if this family or families in Lower Gwinnett need our help to reach out, that we will help them and we will keep it confidential on the police side.
Yeah, Tom, he's very good.
He's phenomenal. I have friends in town. I said, please pass it on. I don't want to know who they are, but if they need something, they should call us. And we'll let them help. I don't want them to feel sheltered that we're not, we're afraid of them. We're not afraid.
Just for everybody else, Paul, Tom Sullivan is the director, the Montgomery County Director of Public Safety.
Director of Public Safety.
Right, and Craig's been instructed, anything he needs, go ahead and take care of it. First, talk to the supervisors later, but we don't want to get in the way of anything at any point. Also figure out how to fund it or whatever we have to do to bring it in line later. Also, the governor has signed an emergency decree. He's to suspend normal due process because of this, and if we need to, we would take full advantage of that. Is there anybody in the audience that has any questions of Craig or Dan or the chief or anybody up here? Any questions?
I was wondering about those masks you're talking about. That's for you to prevent you from contracting?
It's used twofold. So first, if we go into a house and someone's infected, the first thing we would do is put a mask on the individual. So they're not coughing to us. Then we would protect ourselves if in the case of this one resident, we protect ourselves. That's it. That's a mask for us. We were close contact within 6 feet, lifting them, assisting them, putting them on stretcher.
Because you see a lot of people walking around with just the normal blue little cloth.
And the CDC does not recommend it. It's not really needed. Mm-hmm. It's a comfort level. Go ahead and do it, but the CDC is not recommending it.
Okay.
I have some better shirt if you want. This is just basically directing the CDC some stuff if you're interested.
Thanks, Brian.
And all.
Appreciate all the help.
Absolutely.
While Frank is doing that, I want to move on here. We have received the minutes of February 11th and February 28th. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Any questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Next is the resolution around the Sparango three-lot subdivision. Kenny, can you go through on that a little bit?
I will do my best.
Yes.
Thank you. For your consideration this evening is a resolution relative to a subdivision proposed by at Sparango. It's known as Springhouse Court. And the property it's to be constructed on is a 1.32 acre piece of land just north of the reserves at Trewellen on Bethlehem Pike. The applicant proposes three new carriage homes, which will be much like the carriage homes in the existing reserves. It has been reviewed, the project has been reviewed by Gilmore and Associates as the township engineer for site engineering and for sanitary sewer service. It's been reviewed by the township's traffic engineer, by the fire marshal, and has been reviewed and recommended for approval by the Lower Gwinnett Township Planning Commission. There's a resolution at everyone's place, which has just been updated by Mr. Spears, and that resolution conditions approval on compliance with all of the staff and consultant comments, as well as payment of all the applicable fees. The applicant's representative is here, along with their engineer, and if there's any other information that you'd like the board to hear, this would be the time.
Okay. I think that we...
Could you come up and use the microphone?
Oh, sure. Sorry. Susan with Stout Technology, STA Engineering, and the engineer for the plant, and I agree with Ken, and we're going to work through all the engineer's letters. We'll comply with all the letters. We are also obtaining a PennDOT permit for the driveway access. That's in the works. And when we were with the Planning Commission, they asked that we provide for post signs for the driveway.
be overnight parking, is there no overnight parking? And the other question from that for Bob was the fact that the Montgomery County Planning Commission objected the access on Bethlehem Pike. However, the problem is that the applicant does not own access to the other property and was unable to reach an agreement, and therefore, by their way, they're allowed to use Bethlehem Pike as long as they get how the occupancy permit, which apparently is in the works and I understand it's being approved.
It is. As a minimum use driveway, because there's only three residents, and we just have to provide proof of a driveway access agreement. So once we provide that proof, then they'll issue the permit.
Okay, Mr. Spears, I have a question for you here. Why do we need a resolution for this? Could you explain that?
Because you're required, when land development is submitted, you must either approve or deny it within a limited period of time. This is your approval of the resolution if they met your conditions. If you don't do that, then their original plan gets approved by speaking to this called deed approval. So if you don't act on the resolution, you just let it go, then whatever they ask for, they get. And if you just turn it down, we have to explain why you turned it down. So this resolution puts in conditions that the applicant has certain waivers, you're giving those waivers. Your consultants have made certain conditions on how they think the plan can be better. And rather than arguing or fighting whether they're absolutely legal or not, they agree they're fine and the things that can be done. So it's the balancing act. This is the resolution. Happy with approval or denial. By doing the resolution, it allows you to balance things out with the conditions. And besides, everyone's lenders going to ask for a copy of the resolution and not be alone.
Oh, that's important.
Yes.
That's important. Do I have any discussion from any members of the board?
Yes. Is there any hope with renegotiation with the development to your right, it's a shame. It's a real shame that the entrance into this three-lot subdivision can't be adjoining exit and entrance to
Truewell
and Reserve. And I know you've tried, and because not only Truewell and Reserve, but your development, and then there's another development down the way for visibility getting in and out of there on the pipe is not going to be easy. But all right, I just thought I'd bring it up.
Did you know what the objections are? They're just said they weren't interested. I think one of the main things is it's going through their open space and they have all the documents, community documents, and you have to be rewritten to allow for that to happen, and it's have to go through all the association and the numbers.
Okay, any more questions from the board? Is there any questions from the audience? Mark, would you come on up and state your name and address?
Mark Schaefer, 23 Brookline Court. I just wonder how this would impact South Truewell Trail. I just pulled it up and basically showed it right around that property. I'm just curious how it fits in as use of that trail. Just curious.
So I do have this plan that we'll be submitting with the revisions, and this is the plan that was also submitted to the township engineer that showed how we could fit that trail connection in.
Did you use the
it's not electronic because it was just something we were kind of going back and forth.
Yeah.
But the trail comes through back in here, it's white. You can hardly see it. And then the driveway for the three homes will be connected with an 8-foot wide trail.
The impact on the existing trails is more my question. Users or temporary closures and that?
Three homes, I don't know that it had a huge impact.
I just wasn't sure. You put a home on the trail, just wondering, so you're, it circumscribes the property, I'm saying.
The planning commission wanted us to be able to provide these three homes with access to that trail.
Are there any more questions from the audience? Can I have a motion to accept the resolution?
Make a motion to accept the resolution.
Can I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion is, the resolution is accepted and passes. Thank you for coming. Next on the agenda is the presentation of the MS4 requirements by Gilmore Associates. Our engineer, Jim Hirsch, would you take it, please?
I can, thank you, Mark. So from time to time, Craig asks me to come in front of the public and the board to discuss MS4 requirements, sometimes talking about specific projects that we're working on or new regulations, but in light of the fact that we have two new supervisors and for the public's benefit, I thought I'd go through a brief overview of the permit and requirements. I'll try and keep it as brief as possible, and then we'll leave some time at the end for questions from anyone. So just as like an agenda, introduction, overview of the requirements, kind of what you expect.
Revised resolution. Thank you. And I spent additional attachment there too.
So starting off, what is MS4? What does it stand for? MS4 stands for Municipal Separate Storm Sewer System, a collection of township inlets and pipes within the road, stormwater basins, swales, really anything that collects stormwater and then ultimately discharges it to the waterways that divert the township is part of the MS4. An MS4 permit is a permit from PADEP given to the township, authorizing the township to operate the MS4 system and discharge stormwater to the surface waters, which in the state of Pennsylvania are considered waters of the Commonwealth. So the streams are owned by the state. The permit and the whole kind of system began in 2003. So since 2003, the township has been complying with all permit requirements and amending procedures as necessary. About every 5 years, the township has to update the permit, renew the permit, and at that point in time, you're complying with a new set of regulations slightly amended for the next 5 years. In determining what is and what is not part of the township's MS4, we go through a process called parsing. We're allowed to remove areas of the township that aren't the township's responsibility. They would be direct discharge to the creek. So if there's a private property, rainwater hits that private property, runs into the creek, never touches anything that the township owns or maintains, so we are not responsible for that. So we take that out. This map up here is a map of the whole township and two watersheds. Top right is the Little Neshaminy Creek, and the balance of the township is in the Wissahickon watershed. So the gray areas are areas we were able to take out. Recently, as part of the permit submission, PADEP reviewed this and agreed with it. So, moving forward, this is what everyone agrees is what the township is responsible for.
So you're not responsible for the light gray?
We are responsible for everything but the light gray.
And I mean, what's the primary reason why you're not responsible? Like somebody else's golf course or something?
Yeah, so like Old York Road's on there in the light gray. Much of Old York Road Fringe, all of it drains to the creek. It never touches anything the township owns. So like we can't be held responsible for that rainwater. Also, there's a lot of areas that drain to state highways. And that PennDOT essentially is responsible for, they have their own MS4 permit. So we take out those areas as well.
Okay.
So I would say those are probably the two major ones. If you've got a private development, private community where the roads aren't dedicated to the township and the HOA maintains the storm sewer system and the basins, then we take those out as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. So within the permit, there are what they call minimum control measures, and there's six of them, MCMs. Up there's a list of them. Number one is public education and outreach. Two is public involvement and participation. Three is illicit discharge detection elimination. Four, construction site stormwater runoff control. Five is post-construction stormwater management. And six is pollution prevention and good housekeeping. Give an overview of what those six are. Kind of lumped number one and number two together as public education, outreach, and involvement. Ways that the township can communicate or communicates to residents on stormwater issues. This is basically the gist of one and two. So the township website, if you go there, there's a stormwater information page you can click on. There's links to stormwater articles, making sure that you're picking up your pet waste, because when it rains, that gets washed into the creek and adds things that shouldn't be in the creek. And when you're washing your car, if you're washing your car and you're using the soap runs down your driveway into a storm drain that gets to the creek that adds pollutants to the creek that shouldn't be there. Township newsletter as well is a good information or good vehicle to deliver to the public on a quarterly basis, Craig?
Twice a year.
So twice a year, Township puts out a newsletter, spring and fall, is that right? And Craig has asked me from time to time to highlight projects that we're working on, the retrofit of the basins at Springhouse Farms, or maybe a rain garden project, and then we kind of talk about the benefits of stormwater management, and that's a kind of a good way to communicate. There's also other as well. And so public meetings, like tonight, talking about stormwater, but then the EAC has monthly meetings and they have stormwater stuff on their agenda as well. The EAC has in the past put on rain barrel workshops where they've given rain barrels to residents who would want them, and then also educate them about the importance of reducing stormwater runoff the streams. EAC has a table at Pike Fest, if I'm not mistaken, where they hand out educational materials, and then just general public meetings. We report on MS4 to DEP every single year, and Jamie keeps a running tabulation of everything that the township is doing to comply with every MCM, so that's kind of where I pulled some of the information from one and two from. Number three is illicit discharge detection elimination. So the township MS4 system, every point where water flows from our system into the stream is marked on a map. It's called our outfall map. And there are 209 locations where we discharge into the creek. So current requirements, once every 5-year permit term, we have to screen those outfalls for dry weather flow. And so protocols from DEP can't have rain measurable rainfall within 3 days of the screening. And my office goes out and you look at every single outfall, and if there's flow coming from that outfall during a period of dry weather, then we sample it and we send it to the lab to find out what's in it. Really what you're trying to do is figure out if people have made illegal sewer connections to the storm sewer system and are sending treated flow into the creek. So in the event that we get a positive test for any of the contaminants, then we go back and investigate further, but have someone put a camera up it and see if there's any punch-in laterals and whatnot, and just continue to investigate. But I want to say 3 years ago, on the last permit term, we screened all the outfalls, and there were some with dry weather flow. A lot of times it's groundwater getting into the system. But all the samples came back negative, so we didn't have to investigate any further. number four and number five are construction site runoff control, which is erosion and sediment control for during construction projects, and then five is post-construction stormwater management control for after a construction project has been complete. The ENS control, erosion and sediment control, the plans are reviewed by the Montgomery County Conservation District if the project requires an MPDES permit, so larger projects over 1 acre are reviewed by MCCD, and then any projects under 1 acre, if you have a new single-family house, they're reviewed by my office for standard ENS controls, silt fence, rock construction entrance, basically making sure that once the site is disturbed and it rains and runoff happens, nothing's polluting the neighboring streams. And then five is post-construction stormwater management control. That MCM requires that the township adopt a stormwater management ordinance that is consistent with PADEP's minimum requirements, and then also any plans for the specific streams within the township, so in our case, the Wissahickon and the Little Neshaminy. And then, so in 2017, we adopted the township-wide stormwater management ordinance that is up to date in compliance with all those requirements. So that's it's not a problem. And then any project that comes in that proposes greater than 1,000 square feet of impervious is subject to stormwater management and gets reviewed by my office, whether or not that's a project that's big enough to come in front of you supervisors, or just requires a permit from Ken's office, then we review it. The number six is pollution prevention, good housekeeping. This is like your standard procedures for, say, your public works yard, for how to prevent contaminants from getting into the streams. This would be like making sure that the floor drains in a public works garage are tied into the sanitary sewer rather than just tied into the storm sewer and then discharged to the creek. It's also keeping up with the township, keeping up with education. So a few times a year, Jamie will go to some MS4 training, or Craig will view webinars on MS4 related stuff, or stormwater in general. We keep track of all that, and when we let DEP know that the township is maintaining sort of continuing education on the issues. And then also removing debris from inlets, from, I'm sure you guys sweep the streets, from any swales that you might own, to make sure that there's no debris getting into the creeks. Also, you have a few basins that you own, and so maintaining them and keeping them free of debris and sediment is important. Electronics recycling days, if you give people the opportunity to bring their, you know, old electronics to the township, they're less likely to dump them somewhere than then seep into the ground or run off into the creek. And EAC, battery disposal boxes, is another. So, like, just looking ahead, we recently had what we call a pollution reduction plan approved. And so that was a plan we submitted about 3 years ago, and DEP just reviewed at the beginning of this year. And so there was a collection of BMPs that we proposed to be installed that will reduce the increased water quality in the streams. And some of those projects were actually completed in the 3 years since we submitted the plan, and that's namely the rain garden that we constructed here on the township building property, the two retrofitted rain gardens or basins that happened behind the township building, and then the Springhouse Farms basin retrofits. So we're ahead of the game. We have 5 years to 5 years from the approval of the plan, which is going to come this month. So 5 years from this month to complete all the BMPs we contemplated, and there's only really like three more that we'll need to do. So, you know, looking ahead, you'll hear from me probably around budget season for one that I would suggest doing next year. Like, I think that if you did one a year for the next 3 years, you'd be easily compliant with that. And then also tonight to improve the water quality in Wissahickon. That's a nutrient TMDL. Mark has been the point person for the township and going to those meetings, and I'm sure he can update on the process if anyone has any questions or where they are in the process. But you know, at a certain point, the EPA is going to approve a plan for 16 different communities within Wissahickon, and we're going to have to work on installing stormwater management controls to reduce the amount of nutrients in the Wissahickon. And then just continue MS4 compliance and review the program and adapt as necessary. There's a process called an MS4 mock audit that we have also gone through with some municipalities that I represent. We did these about 4 years ago, and we're going to be doing them again coming up. We partner with a firm from Central PA called Land Studies, and they have someone on staff that's certified to audit the program essentially the same way that EPA would audit your program if they came in and said, show us everything you've been doing and tell us why. So I found that was very beneficial for the townships that did it 4 years ago, to kind of identify some areas where you might be able to do a better job. And then it also shows that you're willing to go above and beyond the call to, increase water quality. So in the event that you were audited, it would at least show that you guys were in front of it. So those are just...
You got any credit for that?
Do credit?
Like, I have a mock audit that we can produce to mention.
I mean, I would use it to, I don't think credit, like,
yeah, you're good. Thanks for credit.
But I do think it shows that you care, and it shows that you want to kind of like look in the mirror in your program. Because what happens is, like, we submit annual reports to the EPA. I outline every single thing that we're doing. In my eyes, you are doing a really good job. And I see a lot of these programs, and you're definitely like at the head of the class. But that's not to say that like the head of the class isn't still not good enough for DEP.
Right.
So this would at least identify some areas where you can maybe do a better job.
Any questions from the board?
No, I don't have any questions. I like to comment. Excellent job that you did here. And the presentation was excellent. But for the residents that are here, we have to get together as a township, no matter what side of the party you're on, to have a charge to go to the state, because it's an unfunded mandate. We get a lot of instructions. The state gets instructions from Washington. Washington gets instructions to the state. And then it comes down to us. We have to do this, and you can see all the work has been done, right? And guess who pays for it? This level, with no state aid, no federal aid, or whatsoever. And we have to start making some noise. And so that's the point I wanted to make. Mark heads up a group. He's put in enormous amount of time himself, between he and the manager of Upper Dublin, and he'd be gone for an hour to tell you what has to be done, what they're doing, and so forth. If there's any grants coming from, I hope there are grants coming from the state or the federal government, but the residents of this township should some way, shape, or form, and obviously this is thought, as for trying to get some state or federal money for all this work that you're doing, because they love to tell you what to do, but they're not going to give you any grants or anything. and stormwater runoff is major, major, major. Thank you, Jim. That's all I have to say.
Any questions from the audience?
I'd like to ask a question. Thank you for that presentation, Jim. It was informative. I think that the outreach that you have listed that the township has for citizens is, if somebody's very interested, they'll seek it out. But I wonder if there's something additional that we could do as the environmental committee to actually have more of an outreach with particularly people that live right in the watershed area. Is there some way to educate people or make them a little bit more aware of the needs for keeping the waterways clean?
People that live directly adjacent to the stream, sometimes we organize stream cleanups. I've seen that in a lot of townships. I'm not sure, Mark, does the EAC do that at all?
Yeah, maybe it'll help. I can answer that question.
Okay, good.
Does the audience have any questions? Before I get to that question, it's a complicated issue. That is right. I can go on for hours. I never thought this was going to take me this much time. Paul Leonard and myself, Paul is, as Ed said, is the manager of Redondo. We're co-chairs. We have 13 municipalities and 4 wastewater treatments in the program. We've met for 3 years. We hired Temple. We hired an environmental engineering firm. We produced a study and a plan of action. It's over 300 pages. It's 300 pages of account. We are trying to convince the EPA that the problem with the stream is not phosphorus. It's not nitrogen. They came in with a TMDL. TMDL means total maximum daily load. It's the nutrients that are in the stream. Nutrients kill wildlife that are in the stream. It's the bug score primarily that EPA and DEP are using. What's the bug score? Bugs, in a healthy stream, you'll have all kinds of bugs in the stream. They'll live there naturally. They're canaries in the coal mine. Our bug score in Wissahickon is poor in deep light. Very, very poor. EPA came in and said, oh, you have a impaired stream. We are going to tell you how to fix it. They came in and said, okay, the TMDL study that they did says it's phosphorus. Phosphorus is what they say every stream has in it. Why? Because there is some phosphorus in it, especially if there's a wastewater treatment plant. But Lower Atlantic has spent millions along with the surrounding townships to upgrade the Ambler plant. The phosphorus in the stream, according to Temple's study, has dropped dramatically over the years. However, our bug score got no better. And that's the metric. So what they told us basically is you have to get your phosphorus down lower than it is. Temple pointed out that the background phosphorus that washes into the stream is higher than the standard EPA has set. So if we took every human being out of the Wissahickon watershed, planted the trees, bulldozed the houses, got rid of the humans, we could still not meet the EPA standard. The only way to meet the standard, to start to meet the standard, would be to bulldoze the Ambler wastewater treatment plant, build a new one, start thinking just the plant at $60 million. There's no state aid. So it would be like a bond or bonds in all the townships for each wastewater. There's 4 of them now. All the townships for each wastewater treatment would have to fund new ones or retrofit them. The
The Ambler plant can't be retrofitted anymore, it's out of physical room. It's also the oldest one on the Mississippi. And, but it's been a lot of capital expenditures over the last several years in terms of millions of dollars to bring it up to current code. So they came in and said, that's what we're gonna do. They gave us an opportunity to come up with a plan B, an alternate theory. We hired Temple. Temple did a study. Temple's study says, in a nutshell, it goes on for hundreds of pages, that it's not phosphorus. The problem with the creek is hydrology. Hydrology means all this water runoff from all the impervious surface in Lower Gwinnett. Is when we have a storm event, everybody's driveway, all the roads, there's no place for the water to go. We cut down all the trees, or many trees, right? Trees are one of the best protectors you can have. All that water runs into the creek, it erodes the sides of the creek, it washes out the bugs, it drops our macroinvertebrate score. We will never get that score up unless we do something about hydrology. So this plan we put in place that we presented to EPA in September of last year, they came back to us recently and said, we're going to talk to the state. They didn't say yes, they didn't say no to the plan. The fact that they're interested in talking to the state is a really, really good sign. This is not going to be cheap. It's going to be a lot cheaper than starting with the $60 million water treatment plant, I can tell you that. And we're working with the University of Maryland. They have a environmental finance group down there to help figure out how we're going to pay for all this. The plan is a 20-year plan in 5-year increments. You know, why is that important? We just heard about the controls. There's nothing in the regulations that currently exist that says how you manage this. So we told EPA we as the township, municipalities, not just townships, because Ambler's in there, in Northern, but in the city of Philadelphia's in there too, by the way. It's the controls you just saw. We've agreed to say, we told them that we'll agree to the new controls in addition to the controls we have and use the permits for outfalls that we currently have, and that's going to be their enforcement mechanism. So these mock audits are going to get a lot more real, and everything we do has to be over and above the work of the MS4 requirements. So we have to monitor the outfalls, we have to examine the dry runoff from the pipes, we have to do all these things. Well, these new controls are on top of those controls. We're hoping, as terrible as that sounds, and it is burdensome, this is the least painful path, providing they allow it. They don't have to allow it, because the United States government, the EPA, is in control of all these waterways. And Wissahickon is not a mud puddle, or you might think it is. It's a small stream, but it's under their regulation. They're in control, and DEP then falls under them. DEP is like the cop. So if they agree, if EPA allows this, then DEP is going to come in with their own regulation. And then how are we going to manage it and administer it? Well, tomorrow I was going to testify at the Montgomery County Planning Commission, and that's been canceled. And the presentation was around how we're going to do this, because we've already hired the consortium of townships and wastewater treatment plants doesn't have staff. We had a budget of over $1 million, I think it was $1.5 million. Townships all put in money. William Penn Foundation put in money, all the NGOs are involved, Pennsylvania Environmental Commission's involved, WBWA is involved, we have a lot of NGOs and engineering firms involved, but we're not organization, an entity, like a municipal authority. And we don't want to be, at least not now. So a few weeks ago, we contracted with the county to help provide labor. And that's what I was going to testify about, how we're going to use the labor that the townships, municipalities have already contracted for, because they don't know. Because nobody's done this. So now we've had some counties do it nationwide, but their setups are different. So like your county's got something like this, but the county's in charge, the county runs it. The counties aren't gonna run this. There's no municipal authority in the Delaware Valley that says we're in charge of Wissahickon. Now there is one for the Delaware River, New Jersey and Pennsylvania, and about, but there is nothing. EPA says they don't have any like that. They know that if they agree to our terms, proposed terms, that surrounding watersheds, we're calling it, don't want to do it. We don't know where it's all going to end. It's going to be expensive. So, those permits, they're a big deal. And we still have a lot of work ahead of us. So, and how many questions?
So is the cost mainly associated with labor? Is there additional controls that we're going to put in place?
These projects are huge. So we've identified projects up and down the city that we're going to do for stormwater control. We have flooding. Mm-hmm. Inlet is flooded. Now, where's the big source of that water? Locally, where is it? A big piece of that seems to be the dam over at Wissahickon. Not used to talk about it. So anyway, we have to look at the dam. Now, how much does a dam cost to fix? Ain't going to be cheap. And I'm just saying, we don't even own that. That's the school district. So the school district has got a piece of this. So we have other authorities that have a piece. Andler Yards, they just put in a big underwater detention basin. They buried them in the parking lots. They get flooded a lot. I don't know if you know that they do, where they used to. We lost some school buses down there. Right? Big problem. Now with their flood control that they put under their parking lot, we're hoping, and I hope engineer took a look at that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that it gets metered out. In other words, when the water comes in, it just doesn't run into the creek. So we have things like that everywhere. We also have hidden detention basins and detentions. Hey, did you finish your study, Jim? Did you find them all?
The hidden ones? We found a good number of basins that were not on the township's map that we are investigating ownership of.
Right. And are these basins that need to be rebuilt?
I'm sure that some of them need to be maintained better than they are being currently maintained. The township does a good job of maintaining the basins that they own. There are certain developments that were approved during a time when HOAs were very new to society in general. And so in some instances like that, the HOA may not be well established and some of the basins have had poor maintenance over time. So they could use love and care.
Yeah, some of these.
We have a way to address that.
Very, very good question, right? So that's one of our unknowns. I'll tell you what Upper Dunlop did. And we have this problem to some extent. There are, when some of these developments got put in, a basin was put on a lot. And they made the lot that adjoined the basin the owner of the whole lot. So now there's two lots. And they made the property owner of that basin responsible for the maintenance. Guess what? Didn't get done. Is not maintained, and we don't own it.
But it's a problem because it's dumping the water into the Wissahickon on an uncontrolled way, and possibly. And even if it's controlled the way it was designed, what we found out through the temple studies was they modeled the outflow of the basin. So let's suppose it's got a 12-inch outflow pipe, and that pipe goes into the stream that runs into the Wissahickon. We found that in the model, if we reduce that 12 inches pipe down to, I'll pick a number, 6 inches or 4 inches, it would meter the water out. Well, currently we don't do that. So we're gonna have to go back and retrofit those basins, put in the easiest thing, we're hoping, put a smaller pipe that will slow down the outflow, which would slow down the water running into the Wissahickon in the storm event. But we don't own some of these basins. So what Upper Devil did was, they went to the homeowners, and they said, look, you gotta fix your basin, you gotta maintain it. And of course, it's very expensive to do. And as Paul tells me, the township manager down there, they offered to buy the basin, like for $1 from the homeowner. And then Upper Devil took over the basin, and then they maintained the basin, so they took, they relieve the homeowner of that responsibility, and it allows the township to maintain it the way it's supposed to be. So that's kind of like, from my point of view, a really good compromise. I think everybody wins on that. And we have some hidden basins where we have some basins that we know are hidden and they're not maintained. So we have this in many locations around the township. So, but the basins are just one of the things we have to do. So, but it's a 20-year plan, at least, 20-year plan, in 5-year chunks. So we have a lot to do. And that's just one of the things that Temple discovered was the stream is not all the same. So they discovered that we have problems, or the stream has problems at various points along it. Some areas have good macro vertebrate scores, but you go 100 yards or a mile down, however far you want to go, and the macro vertebrate scores at that location are poor, or the phosphorus or the nitrogen is high, or the turbidity is high. Turbidity is basically the erosion of the stream walls, and it's washed in. Well, the critters in the stream can't live with siltation. They make their home on the bottom of the stream, and if you cover them with silt, they die.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a suggestion?
Sure.
This is so critical to the residents of Lower Glen Township that we have to, with your help and with the agreement of the board, come up with a way to constantly educate our residents on this. Either with mailings, with adding to the agendas on a regular basis for updates from you. Without a doubt, it's something we have to continue to work on, educating our residents. And as for what we're up against with no financial backing from the state and the federal government.
Right, well, I just have one more thing to answer Tessie's question, right? What are we doing about education? Most of the municipalities, many municipalities have an EAC, as an Environmental Advisory Council. We have one here in Lower Gwinnett. It was formed 10 years ago as Gwinnett Green, and we're now officially, there's legislation that officially allows us to act in a capacity that the state recognizes. It's called the EAC, and we were certified 2 years ago. So we're growing that committee. It's gonna be a big deal. We need a lot of experts in that area, and we're working with the NGOs to educate everybody, because it can't be just one requirement. It's everybody in the consortium. So, WBWA is, they have a big part of that work, and we're working with, I meet with them regularly to do exactly what you just said.
Yeah, I agree with Ed, though. We need to think about keeping this in front of
correct. Yes, you are. Okay, does anybody, I went on for longer than I wanted to. Does anybody have any questions?
No.
Just wondering. So, who determines, you know, when you build, like, you know, the big Whole Foods complex? You know, there used to be lots of grass, lots of fields, lots of trees. How well managed that is. And that pond was already there, and I'm not exactly sure exactly what that does, but it was always there. I don't know, who determines if it's successful?
The building code, our engineer, they can't.
You mean him?
Yes, Jim. The state regulates it. You can't build anything, and correct me if I'm wrong, Jim, you can't put net water runoff into any of the streams anymore. Is that right, Jim?
Yeah, so in an instance like the Whole Foods development, the developer hires an engineer, that engineer comes up with a stormwater management plan that they believe complies with the township's ordinances. They submit that along with their land development plans to the township. My office reviews that against the ordinances and determines whether or not it's correct. If we believe there's some things that need to be addressed, we would tell them, we review it, and it's back and forth. And then ultimately, there's an approved plan. And then our office is out during construction to confirm that they're building what they said they were going to build, what the approved plan says. And at the end of the whole project, there's a final as-built survey of everything that gets submitted to the township, gets reviewed to make sure that everything is actually, you know, to the foot built like it was supposed to. So I think that kind of answers the question on like how do you know
but
it
basically
works.
Hypothetical.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest with you, like stormwater management and hydrology is built in theory. It's, every single storm is different. So you're hoping and you're assuming based on historical rainfall data that the stormwater facilities are adequate, but we make sure they comply with all the ordinances.
Mark?
And just so you know, the EAC went over there and then checked every tree that they were putting in. Be sure they met with the native plant ordinance of the township. We did the same thing with Twin Mercy University when they put in a new road. We went and checked new plants, be sure to guess they are putting in native plants where they're going. So there is a process working with the township and the EAC. Here we can to do it right.
Right. And they're probably very useful in that.
Yeah, well, that time to plant a tree was 20 years ago, so trees are important, yes. Okay. Any more questions?
I hope that the EAC develops a program to demolish trees.
We did that at Pike Fest 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, I believe.
We also did that at the recycling events.
Right.
That's great.
Yeah, and in fact,
it could.
Our biggest difficulty was when people come to the way of the tree, we say, are you a lower grade resident? Because if you were stipulated, you could just give it to anybody who walked up. But we got rid of them. We get them at a discount and we bring them in ourselves and ask to do that.
And we're working on formalizing that more. So it's just not a giveaway now and then. We have a formalized policy of how we're going to do it. Yeah, well, one of the problems is, too, that let's suppose that we've been in as room for trees, and we as the township have some trees and we want to give them to them. It's a problem, given the township funds to apply to them. We have to figure this out, right? So, it's just something else on the list. A lot of work to do, EAC's been busy, a lot more work. Melissa, do you have any more questions? We have one more thing on our couple more things. The Pet Ambler Road is a maintenance agreement. Is this
the maintenance agreement for sanitary sewer line? New house on 810 Pet Ambler Road. This is just an agreement between us and them for an 18-month period that they will maintain the line and put it in.
Do you need a
signature? Yeah, it's just authorization assigned.
Okay. all we have to do, that's easy. Is there any questions from the board in the audience? Okay. Now we come to the most interesting part, citizens' comments, concerns, or questions on any topic. Yeah, come out, speak in the microphone.
You need your name and address too.
My name is Joan Zeller. I live at 420 Brookside Avenue. And this past, what's today? I'm newly retired, so I can't keep track of days.
It's Tuesday. Today's Tuesday.
So I met Kathleen. I saw Kathleen down at the Amber Yards presentation of the proposed residential part of Amber Yards. And I'm happy to be here. So my question is, how much do you balance the concerns of the local residents to the prospective developers? I don't know if it's a, you have a...
Well, usually, if a developer comes in with a plan, they come in to the planning commission, and you have a right to go there and make comments. And then the planning commission will make changes, directions for us. Then we take a look at it, and it's open to the public. And if there's something that you don't like or want them to change, I would recommend that you start at the ground level so that they're not spending a lot of money on doing something that you're obviously or may obviously be against, and you would prefer them to change it. I would start with the planning commission. So we'll make the staff aware of your name and address, and when they come in with a plan, we'll let you know about it. And just to come at it from the start.
I have been.
Okay.
I have been to, you know, I've met Mark and
Matt.
Two Matt's and Matt. So I've been very clear, and a number of us on this meeting have been very clear. Because it's, another point is that the area that they want to build on, I noticed that is not zoned for that, and what it takes to say, yes, I can put up apartment buildings in your single family residence, you know, community. I don't know what it takes to do that.
So, obviously, you're concerned about the character of your community. You've been living there for some time, and you don't want a negative impact. And you're correct, they come to us, they need a zoning change to do what they want. That's purely a voluntary legislative act. We can act on it, or we don't have to act on it. Mm-hmm. But I would look at what they can do by right. In other words, what they can put there under the current zoning. Is that preferable to Lower Gwinnett Township and the neighboring residents? Mm-hmm. Or is this apartment building, which has morphed a number of times, keeps getting better, in my opinion, but is the by right use better or worse than what they're proposing to do?
Well, knowing where the demarcation line is, at least it would be, whatever it is, back there, you know, a little bit farther back, you know. I think it's at least 200 feet.
Yeah,
so I don't know what they were doing back there. Maybe that's just fine. I haven't seen any alternative.
Have the residents in the immediate area communicated directly with the owners or the managers of the property?
Yeah, last week.
Yeah, they had an open house.
And was there like give and take or, you know, stonewall?
Well, he just said that this is what we're proposing, and you know, it'll come up to the board or whoever.
Yeah, it was a conversation.
Yeah.
Information sharing, conversation. It was very relaxed.
they can turn down those imports. They don't need a whole lot of changes, that's fine. So, I mean, that would be probably what they would propose in the event that the change that they're requesting to move it to apartments or multi, you know, multi-family unit would be. So, if, is it really about, what we're saying is that at this point right now, they haven't brought anything to the planning commission, to the zoning board, to us. It's communication that you would probably need to engage in with the owners of the property. I know because we're neighbors, I have voiced my opinion, and I would suggest to the board.
Well, the first time they came up with the, what was it, the dungeon kind of thing? And I made my displeasure at the whole notion. I believe it was Mark, said, well, then we'll just build a bigger, you know, office building. And all there are limits to that, but you know, how high they can be.
That gets back to the byway use, that's the negotiation, right? So it's a give and take process, but we don't have anything in front of us. So I know they've had some community presentations down there. So the first time they want to do something formally, it's going to go to the planning commission. And since you're within 500 feet, I'm assuming.
I'm in the middle of the block.
Right, the road.
Yeah, so you would get notified.
You got notified for that meeting, correct?
Not the planning commission.
I did. They did say that, they said this time, oh, we send it all the way up.
Yeah.
All sides of the street.
You're outside of the footage where the planning commission would have to notify you.
Okay, yeah. But I took another neighbor who was on Francis, that was about 3 half houses in Pendleton, and he never got a letter. And I know some other people did get letters.
But this is maybe the best time to communicate with the owners while these plans are being developed. Because if they understand there's a significant pushback from the surrounding community, perhaps that would help them understand they need to change what they're proposing.
So if they don't, and they just say, I like what I made, it's a pretty building, and I said that to them, but it just, doesn't fit in.
I think you just want to be as specific as you can be. So if your issue is fundamental, you don't want that type of structure there, then that would be what you're conveying. But if it's another specific aspect of the building, meaning access, or if it's some level of aesthetic, I don't think, whatever your specific issue would be, to convey that at this point could be the most helpful thing, so that they have a better understanding of how the immediate community at least feels about the
Another area that's having some issues with speed and traffic increasing, and so that's another worrisome aspect about adding a large building. So, I think the owners need to understand the concern. I'm sure they have some appreciation, but if they face a lot of opposition from the community, that might reinforce that this is an unpopular idea. But I think, you know, with the guy about the fire right, possibilities for what they can do.
And they just seemed on the face of it in my interaction with them and the fact that they had a community meeting that they're trying to be not just, you know, community, but other communities who probably would appreciate the feedback. Actually, that's just my
assessment. My first feedback was not
pleasant.
Was not received well. I'll just say, build a bigger, you know, something like it.
Yeah. Well, maybe we need to assist them in being of our community and not just in it.
Okay.
So that open line of communication could be beneficial.
Thank you. And that's not your only opportunity. You'll have the planning commission however many times they want to meet and entertain the application, and then before us if it gets that far. So you'll have plenty of time. Your voice will be heard.
Good. Thank you.
Well, are there any
Okay, meeting's adjourned, thank you for coming.